go then. Hi, everyone. Welcome back. Please give a warm welcome to our next speaker, Hila. She's going to do a lovely talk.
Thank you. Okay. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining my talk. A bit disclaimer, I'm a bit sick. I'll try to not overbear you with coughs and stuff. So, writing code is something that we all learned, I assume, right? But managing a project end-to-end, probably not that much. So in this talk, I will share my journey of migrating an entire R&D codebase from BitBucket Cloud to self-hosted GitLab on my own, but of course with help and collaboration with other teams. I will discuss here implementation, planning, documentation, and handoff. I will share best practices for managing a technical project with a lot of key takeaways that you can take in order to incorporate in your projects. But first of all, hi, my name is Hila Fish. I'm a senior DevOps engineer and I work for Wix. I have 15 years of experience in the tech industry, which means that I managed quite a lot of projects, migrations, integrations, the whole works. I'm a DevOps culture fan. I think this is what helps companies achieve great things, and this is really helps me to manage projects in my day-to-day because I'm all for communication and collaboration. And on my spare time, I'm a lead singer in a cover band, as you can see in this picture, which is a lot of fun. So, one question for you all. The project that I'm gonna share with you here, the migration, took, all in all, 1 month and a half. Do you think it's a lot and you would be able to do it in less time than that? If so, raise your hand. Okay, cool. Did you think this is too little and you need more time to in order to incorporate it? Then raise your hand. Okay, most of the crowd thinks like that. So first of all, thank you. I appreciate the fact that you understand that this was indeed a tight schedule. But this question was actually a trick question, because how can you estimate how much time it will take you to do any project if you don't know the requirements, if you don't know what actually is needed? So think about it this way whenever you need to do any estimations for anything and someone asks you, give me an estimation. Wait, I need to check what is needed, right? So that's about that. So the project structure that I'm gonna share and basically also the agenda for this talk is that. First of all, planning what to think about in order to migrate the repositories, things to consider, foresee any bottlenecks as much as possible, of course, and tackle them upfront, deadlines, etc. Implementation, so it was an overview of the needed steps along with needed considerations such as needed integrations. We used Jenkins and Jira, so we had to integrate those. Security aspects, handling expected blockers, and also leave room for the unexpected. Training for the R&D department, they didn't know anything about GitLab and they had to do and use it in their day-to-day in something very major as source control management. So I had to incorporate it in the plan as well. Documentation and handoff. Documentation both for my team to handle it and also for the R&D to use it. And the fun fact, I left the company that I worked for shortly after doing this migration. So I knew that I have to have a very good handoff to make sure that my team knows exactly how to manage the platform, especially because I did the migration all by myself. And hovering above everything is project ongoing statuses, because I wanted to make sure my team leader knows what's going on and to make sure that I have independence going towards the project. So I actually lied. I said that it started with planning. No, it started with a pre-planning. So when I got the task, I first started asking questions to understand the scope of the project. So first of all, I asked, what is my deadline? If I know the deadline, I know if I need to shift other tasks aside, to arrange my time accordingly, to have any other considerations, etc. Also need to ask, why is this migration or project is even needed? If it's because we have a need to move from on-premise to cloud, if we need to use or stop using SaaS, or any internal reason that you think that is really needed in order to grasp the overall extent of the project. So this is where you need to check it, and it's very important. So in order to make sure that the project process and outcome is according to the management needs and requirements, and that way you know exactly what is being done. And also limitations. is there any need to do things in a certain way? So for example, GitLab had two offerings. You can install it on a VM or Kubernetes. And for the company that I worked for, of course, you need to think about what is the major platform that you're using. We used Kubernetes, so of course, the natural thing was to go to Kubernetes because we didn't want to maintain in our day-to-day two platforms, both instances and Kubernetes, and just go with the same infrastructure that we have. So any limitations that you can think of that is crucial to incorporate here, this is something also to consider. So we had this goal to migrate from Bitbucket Cloud to self-hosted to GitLab, but as you can see here, a goal without a plan is just a wish. So once I felt like I have enough information to go on, then I created a high-level plan. That was the plan. Great. And it is great for me, the executor of the plan. But management wants milestones and due dates. This is how they can measure progress and also convey the status in a clear manner. So that's why I've taken this plan and converted it to be actionable and measurable with setting up milestones and due dates. So these are the steps, and I'm going to cover each one. Just first explanation, the two first steps don't have a date to them because they were the prerequisites. So I knew that I have to finish them as quickly as possible and then base all of the other timelines based on the prerequisites. So the first step was telephone code. This is where I created the telephone code in order to create the GCP project. We worked on a Google Cloud. So GCP projects for GitLab dev environment and production environment, and also create the Google Kubernetes engine, the cluster of Kubernetes itself to create it, and also to deploy GitLab on this cluster. Networking troubleshooting. Since networking was handled by a different team, I automatically added a slot here, a dedicated slot for troubleshooting, since it involved not only me. So they have their own agendas, their own timelines. They knew that I had to dedicate a slot here. And it doesn't mean that the networking troubleshooting was only exclusively was in this phase. I had to troubleshoot issues throughout the entire project, but I tried to map all the source and destination that I could possibly think of in order to make sure that I cover most of them here. Next milestone was GitLab up and running. So it means that GitLab is up, including DNS names, certificates, and SAML integration. Next milestone was to have a first migration of a repository. So I had to use the GitLab migration feature, which wasn't that working, and I had to create tickets. So I knew that it will take me some time to do it, and that's why that was a milestone. Once one repository is there, we know that that I have the ability to continue with it because the first hurdle is done. Then, after I know that we can do it, migration is working and everything is good, now it's time to think about peripheral infrastructure. Backups and restores, of course, and also monitoring. So in that phase, I did backups for the entire system of the entire platform for GitLab, repository level, branch level, and also checked how to restore them because you don't want to make sure, you don't want to get to the point where you need to restore and then you realize that all your backups are worth nothing. So I did the restores, made sure that we know how to restore, everything works as expected. So that was about that. And also monitoring to see that everything is monitored and we can have eyes on what's going on. Wait, okay. Next milestone is the second repository got migrated that also have a pipeline. So at that point, we only migrated GitLab as source control management, and we did a decision to not migrate also the pipelines from Jenkins to GitLab because we had a tight schedule. So it means that in this phase, I had to do the Jenkins integrations, all the configurations on both Jenkins and GitLab side to make sure it is working properly and to see that actually whenever the pipeline works, it works and do whatever is needed on the GitLab repository. Then training, gradual gain, and continuous migration. So training both for R&D to be able to work with GitLab and at least be familiar with it before they actually start to work with it. Gradual login is because whenever you work with GitLab, once you do a login with the LDAP user, it needs to create an entity on GitLab side. So during the training, I told them, hey, please log in. And then in one time, I got all the logins that I needed, and then I linked all the permissions. And then in parallel to that, I continued with the migrations because I had more than 200 repositories to migrate. I took all the repositories, divided them to teams, and then I coordinated with each team when I'm going to do the migration, and then it went by pretty smoothly because of a meeting that I did with them, and I will cover it in a bit. And the last milestone is migration is done, documentation is done, and handoffs also are done. So funny story about that is I left the last repository, which was the biggest one and the most crucial one, to the end. I knew it will take a lot of time to migrate this repository because it took like a couple of hours on the dev environment. So I told them, hey, I'm going to do the migration of this repository on the weekend to not disrupt R&D too much, because whenever I did a migration, it means that I'm blocking access from them to push or pull from this repository, and I didn't want to block R&D from doing their job. So I did on the weekend, and let me tell you, after that, when we got back to work, happy days, a lot of issues. I prepared myself mostly mentally, but after all the issues were done, actually, everything was done, and they started working with GitLab fully. Some other things about planning, because again, planning is super crucial. So in order to plan everything, I created a planning doc that consisted of the milestones that I just showed you now, plus these extra sections that I'm going to share with you here. I decided to put them all on that document to have one place that have all aspects referenced. So first steps, a mapping of needed steps for both from my side and external teams, because if I know other teams that needs to do some things, I can open Jira tickets in parallel and have them do it and save some time. To do out of scope high level tasks that we need to do and basically cover it later on. Read more, things to dwell on and deepen our knowledge. I read a lot of things during the migration, and I said to myself, okay, this is important, but not right now. So I cover them in the read more section to read about it once the migration is done. And things to think about. Maybe we need to think about annual audits for doing the for covering users in the new self-hosted platform, etc. So anything to think about should be covered in this section. And also more things to the planning, because why not? We can cover more things to planning, right? So I reported issues that I have encountered, and basically there were issues both on GitLab side and internal issues. I listed them on Jira tickets as well, but that way it was a centralized place for my team leader to check what's going on, what's the status, and if they can help with escalation of anything. Appendices. So I covered network access mapping, inbound, outbound accessibility, anything that needs to be opened to the GitLab as it was open to BitBucket. User access mapping, entities access to the self-hosted GitLab as well. If we need users, we need to know who they are. And something that my team leader added, a main repositories and CI pipelines that needs to be migrated to track progress. He wanted to edit, and then I said, okay, let's edit. And if it makes you feel better and see everything in one place, that's great. Okay. So this was about the project in details. Now I want to cover something here that is very, very important to any project, especially if it's something that you do by yourself, but not only, any project, and it is communication. So Peter Drucker said that the most important thing in communication is hearing what isn't said. I really tried to avoid this sentence. I really tried to not have anything that wasn't said, not have something that wasn't clear, and really try to communicate as much as I could. So what did I communicate? Basically, things for the stakeholders. So weekly team, I had a weekly meeting with my team leader. I wanted to update him on blockers and get assistance with escalating issues if there was a need to do that. I created and updated Jira tickets, both for my team leader to see the statuses on the Jira tickets, and that way, if he wants to know things in between the weekly team meetings, he can just go to the Jira tickets and see the updates on the statuses there as well. But I did have also ad hoc meetings about issues, and then I asked either to escalate or just FYI know that this happened. And this was a very important meeting that I did with the R&D team leaders of all the repositories that are being managed, that were managed in GitLab. I showed them what are we gonna do. I told them why are we doing this migration, and I harnessed them to help me with the migration and really all the 200 repositories that I migrated that I divided to teams. It took me less than a week to migrate everything because I did this preparation meeting. I also involved them in the decision-making process. There was a need to decide on the folder structure on GitLab and where to put the repositories, and the permissions were based on that. So I asked them, what do you think we should do? So I really involved them in decision-making, and I prepared them for the migration, and that way it really helped me to harness them to the cause and get their help in the long run. And also, knowledge is power, right? Information is liberating. So information, when delivered properly, meaning without overbearing the recipient with details, you just need to deliver what they need to know, it transforms to power, and it helps ease the decision-making process, deliver a feeling of stability, and also allows your ongoing independence of running the project. Because if people know what they need to know, then you are independent to keep on going and run forward. Let's talk about the implementation. So we used the Helm chart of GitLab. It had a lot of subcharts, very complex, and we had to. I had to incorporate it into the Terraform code, so I had a lot of things to do there. But the most important thing for me to share with you here is that GitLab was new to me. I didn't know anything about GitLab, didn't use it before, and I knew that I had a tight schedule. So I knew that I really had to rely on the documentation in order to know what needs to be done and to do things properly, because I didn't have much time to play with the system and do like trials and errors. So I knew that I really have to rely on documentation in order to implement it properly. So let's see what decisions I did based on this documentation. So I used a DB version that is different from the charts default. Why did I do that? Because I wanted to prevent later maintenance. They said in the documentation that if you put this version, then it is both suitable for the next version of 14 and also good for backward compatibility. And why they didn't put this version as a default, I don't know, but based on that, it was good, and that way I saved a lot of headache for my team members afterwards to do another migration for the DB itself. And we all know DB migrations can be very, very painful. So you know what I'm saying. So yeah, I wanted to save them this headache. So that's why I used the DB version, which was different from the default. Next up, I didn't implement the high availability feature. And why is that? Because it's very slow. I don't know why. All good. Suspense mechanism. It wasn't a GA feature yet. So I didn't want to rock the boat too much. I didn't want to introduce instability to the system. So that way, I told them, OK, it's not GA yet. Let's not do it yet. But I did put like a comment in the code above the flag off. I put a note, please revisit it once it goes GA, and please implement it. And I hope that my team members did it. And I created Kubernetes dashboards because at that time, they didn't have any Kubernetes dashboards. All the dashboards were only for the VM version. So I basically went through the metrics documentation and created the dashboards myself. And last thing, I backed up the secret to restore the GitLab DB version. So they had this semi-automatic mechanism to backup the database, but they said in order to restore it, you have to backup yourself the secret that is used to restore the database. Why they did it like this, I don't know, but since they wrote it in the documentation, then it was good that I knew it up front, and then I created the cron job to also back up the secret. And by the way, fun fact, they actually changed the official documentation based on the issues that I raised during tickets. So it's fun to have this impact on GitLab and to know that they changed the official documentation because something that we faced. So that's why another reason why documentation is very, very important. Training and support. So it's very slow. I don't know why. Training session. I did a training session with the R&D to make them more familiarized with the tool before actually using it. So I showed them GitLab basic usage, main features, and also I told them, hey, I know you're used to calling it pull request, but GitLab is calling it merge request. It doesn't mean you have to now call it merge request. It just means that once you go to the UI, you can't look with your eyes pull request. It's now called merge request. So it's a small thing, but something that you need to think about whenever you start to work with something new. So I wanted them to be familiar with GitLab before using it. Also, I created a GitLab onboarding doc. Basically, I documented how to change the local copy of the repository to work. The remote origin should be with GitLab now and not BitBucket. I told them how to do it through this doc. This is something that you can do and find it online easily. But the reason I created a document for this is I want to, first of all, to have quick adoption. I don't have time to search online, you have a document to do that. And also to set a sense of support guarantee. If I show them that I support them in even in this level, that they know they can come to me with any GitLab issues. And I also told them during the training session that, hey, dev environment is open to use, please use it. Again, quick adoption, they can play with dev and become more prepared and more confident for the production environment. And also, I created a dedicated support Slack channel where they could raise bugs and issues for ongoing support and also to deliver the best customer service experience possible. And in that Slack channel, I pinned messages about issues that I opened to GitLab so they can track it and see if their bugs or issues got resolved. So that's about that, and that was very crucial in order to really help them adopt GitLab much more faster. Documentation and handoff. So since I knew that I'm gonna leave the company, I knew that the documentation has to be flawless, but also even if I didn't leave the company, I knew that if I don't do it, every time that someone has an issue with GitLab, they would say, ah, Hila managed, Hila deployed GitLab, so go talk to her, she knows what to do. I wanted to avoid that. I wanted to have my team leaders, my team members know exactly what's being done, how the platform is working, etc., so they won't be feeling helpless and they know that they can support the platform as much as me. So that's why I covered really everything that I could possibly think of, from how to deploy a new version of GitLab to how to manage it and replace certificates, and even what information to open when you open a support ticket to GitLab, what information to include in order to avoid ping pong between us and them. I have even had tips for that, which is crucial, especially when it is production environment. We don't have time to wait for support. We want to make sure it is we get response as soon as possible. So I tried to cover everything that I could possibly think of. Okay, I covered a lot of things, planning, documentation, handoffs. Some things are well, GitLab specific, but you could extract the key takeaways from that. Now I want to show you general key takeaways that you can take for your projects to go. So first of all, planning is a must. Especially for long-term project, you have to plan ahead. You need to understand the company's needs, why this project is important, and use the information to try and foresee any bottlenecks and plan how you're going to tackle them upfront, and also derive deadlines based on those information that you've gathered, and then execute accordingly. And why is that? Because structure of the and planning the project will help you achieve things in a timely manner and literally progress according to plan. Next key takeaway is updates and collaboration matters, or communication is key. It doesn't matter if you're working on a project alone or with others, you should always communicate your progress to achieve it independence and end-to-end ownership. And also always involve and bring the stakeholders up to speed managers, team leaders that are affected by the project, etc., including regular updates and also raising flags on issues because you want to harness them to the cause. Brainstorming and collaboration matters, point two. So it's always best to showcase the technical implementation that you are planning to your team members and manager because you want to make them familiarize with the project since they will need to support it later on. But also you want to get their inputs and suggestions. You want, maybe they have something to contribute, say something about the implementation or things that you want to implement and they have another idea to do it. And why is that? Because we want to make sure that we ensure best implementation that is suitable for your use case. You don't want to get to a point where it's too late to change something and then you don't have the best implementation just because you didn't consult with the people that you should consult with. Trade-offs are a given. You will always have a lot of things to consider and take into account. Deadlines, mandatory, nice to have implementations. So you need to make sure you are executing based on that. And also focus on what matters right now. Keep the out of scope items out, even if it's more interesting and it looks more technical and you want to dangle them, still focus on what matters right now to achieve the project success, especially if you are under a tight schedule. And leave buffer time for the unexpected. You never know what could happen, so always leave buffer time to any unexpected issues. Documentation is key, both the documentation that you read while implementing technical and logical aspects, but also the documentation that you leave behind. So read the manual. I can't say this word on stage. It will help you to take the right decisions and have the ability to defend them. And write the manual, leave the documentation behind it for knowledge sharing and preservation. And last but not least, always remember for projects and mostly migration projects, change is hard, okay? When people are used to work in a certain way, you need to take that into consideration when you plan your project, especially if it's a migration project. So communicate the why and the how and help others embrace the change and also leave time for training and it's a very hard word, familiarization with a tool, service or platform, and that way they'll be able to embrace it easier. So that basically was it. I hope that I was able to give you some key takeaways that you can take for your projects to manage in the long run. And that's it. Yeah, thank you so much.
Are there any questions? Okay, then if you don't have any in-person questions, you can always find her on the app. She is pretty active there, helping us out. Thank you for a great talk. Thank you everyone for joining in. Have a nice break.
Thanks again.